Hello everyone. Today I am going to discuss about the water softening process. In last lecture, we discussed about the zeolite method and today we discuss about the ion exchange method. Let us see. Demineralization is a type of water purification, while it can refer to any treatment process that removes minerals from water. The term demineralization is typically reserved specifically for the ion exchange method, which is used for removal of or the total removal of minerals present in a water or which are ionic mineral contaminants. This is a very easy method. The determination or this demineralization process is the modern industrial water softening process. By this process, it can be possible to remove the hardness as well as remove all dissolved salts like FeCO3, CaCl2, etc., which are present in a water. We can also say that the demineralization or deionization is the process of removing dissolved ionized solid from water by ion exchange. The major portions of total dissolved solids, that is TDS, are mineral salts such as calcium bicarbonate, magnesium sulfate, magnesium bicarbonate, sodium chloride. Mineral salts are composed of cations and anions. Deionization requires the removal of all ions, both the negatively charged anion and the positively charged cations. Then minerals capable of attracting both are required. These minerals are also known as the cation and anion exchange resin. These resins are these structure of that resins are like a molecular sieves, which are very small and white in structure, which having a capacity of exchanging cations and anions or the impurity present in a water get captured by these molecular sieves, and equivalent amount of resins are dissolved or released by that cation exchange resin and anion exchange resin respectively. Now the next is demineralization process of water softening. It can be brought about the two ways. First one is the hydrogen cation exchange and second one is the anion exchange. In hydrogen cation exchange, the cation resins can be hydrogen, that is RSO3H, or the sodium form like RSO3Na. The sulfonated resins, the cationic acid resin, is hydrogen form, is used as a cation exchanger for the water softening. In generally, that cation exchange resins are the acidic resins because that acid having a H plus ion, so whenever they are in contact with a water, then the H plus ions are released in water and by anions are captured the cationic impurity present in water. So the reaction is where R is considered as a resin, so that R are the R SO3 minus H plus means a sulfonic acid. So whenever the calcium dichloride type of impurity present in a water sample and it come in contact with a resin like RH2, we know that R H2 means the H2 is the dissociation ions present in acid, and R is the whole remaining structure of that acid. So whenever they react with calcium dichloride, then that resin capture the cationic impurity present in a water, means calcium. So RCA get trapped, resins are get trapped, Ca2 plus present in a water sample, and the remaining 2H are interacted with a Cl2 and forming the HCl. So when the calcium bicarbonate reacted with a cationic resin, then they again capture, we know all that resins, H plus resins are having a capacity only capture the cationic type of impurity present in a water. So that RH plus again captured the, means that resin are captured the cationic impurity, means the Ca plus captured by a resin. Then in product there is the first one is the PPT of RCA with removal of CO2 in the presence of water. This is the second reaction. Second type or that second sub part, part is the anion exchange resin. In anion resin there is use the HCl which is removed, means again anion R is the resin, and use the hydroxide, means any hydroxide structure is used as a anion exchange resin, or is play the role of anion exchange resin, so that whenever we want to dissociate that anion exchange resin, then it can dissociate into R plus and OH minus. So that resins, means the R plus again capture the anion impurity present in that water, so there is in product forming the PPT of RCl in the water, means remaining is the H plus and OH minus, so that there is again forming the H2O. We can see in a diagram there are the two columns. First column is the cation exchange column and second one is the anion exchange column. In cation exchange column there is the yellow band is there that denote the cation exchange resin at the left hand side, and at right hand side column there is yellow band which denotes the anion exchange resin which are tapped in a column. So whenever the at the left hand side, whenever the raw water is inserted, means the first column is the cation exchange resin, after that water is again passed through, means from raw water is inserted into a first column, means the cation exchange column. After all, whenever their process is complete, then that water again passed through a anion exchange column, means the all anions are captured by anionic exchange column and cations are captured by cation exchange column. So the impurity like a cationic and anionic present in water get trapped by these columns and pure water is formed. In this diagram we can see that the raw water is inserted in the first column where the cation exchange resin is packed in a first column which having a H plus and R H plus. So whenever the water is inserted, that water having the anion exchange anionic impurity and cationic impurity, so that cation exchange resin is allowed only to exchange the cationic impurity present in the water. So whenever the water is passed through from the cation exchange resin, all the cations present in water get captured by a resin and anionic impurity, and exchange of R get released in a water, so that all the anionic impurity with removal of H plus get passed through in a second column, where in second column the all anionic impurity like a Cl minus, SO4 2 minus are captured, and here again the OH minus get released, means that H plus is released from the first column and OH minus released from the second column. Then again the addition of H plus and OH minus give the pure water. So at the right hand side we can see that there is the out source or outlet is there which captured the soft water, or here we collect the soft water. This is the in general method is called the demineralization process or the ion exchange process. Now regeneration. How to regenerate then cation exchange resin and anion exchange resin? When the process is done, after some time, the capacity of cation exchanger resin and anion exchanger resin of exchanging the cations and anions which are present in the water captured by that resin get over. And when the capacity of that resin is over, it's called the exhausted resins. And when these exhausted resins are formed, then again we need to regenerate resin to become forming a soft water. So in first column, we know that the regeneration is done to get back the resin which are used to soften the water are exhausted, and we have to apply some acid and alkali, means some acidic acid and base to regenerate them. We know that in a first column there is a acids acid or the cation exchange. We pack the cation exchange resins, and if we want to regain the cation exchange resin, means we require the some cations, and these are formed by using acid. So 2% of sulfuric acid are used. Whenever the exhausted resins, means that on bed, whenever the cation capacity of exchanging is over, on bed there is remaining structure or remaining salts or the chemicals are the RCA2+. So that resins are reacted with sulfuric acid or any acid. We can use HCl, sulfuric acid, or other acid. So whenever we insert that acid, then H+ are again captured by the resin, and Ca2+ means the cationic impurity that captured by resins get again released whenever the acid is inserted, and our resins are regenerated in the form of RH2. In next column, we know that there is the anion exchange resins, means we need to OH- to regenerate this resin. So any base we can use, like NaOH, ROH, KOH, etc. So we use the NaOH, 1% solution of sodium hydroxide used to regeneration of anion exchange resin. So ClR1 plus NaOH, it gives NaCl plus HOR1. The regenerated resin is formed. Now advantage. The variety of cost-effective standard models. Second is improved aesthetics and rough design. Third one is user-friendly. It have a low maintenance and easy to install. It is a simple distribution and collection system. It is quickly availability. Then pre-dispatch assembly check. It is rust-free, less power consumption, durable, most economical, then high shelf life. Then each operation step is clearly marked on the wall, thereby the elimination or the eliminating chances of error is in the operating sequence. Then single value assembly with its simplifying frontal piping, simpler distribution collecting system is very easy to install. Then a single wall operation as compared to the six wall is conventional filters. Then multiple valves are top mounted as well as side mounted with the necessary high pressure rating, means a PVC piping. These are the advantage. Now the next concept is the water distribution system. This is the last part of this chapter. The purpose of distribution system is to deliver the water to consumer with appropriate quality, quantity and pressure. Distribution system is used to describe collectively the facility used to supply water from its source to the point of use. The requirement of good distribution systems. The first one is the water quality should not get deteriorated in the distribution pipes. It should be capable of supplying water at all the intended places with sufficient pressure head. It should be capable of supplying the required amount of water during firefighting. The layout should be such that no consumer would be without water supply during the repair of any section of the system. All the distribution pipes should be preferably laid 1 meter away or above the sewer lines. It should be fairly water tight as to keep losses due to leakage to the minimum. Now the layout of distribution network. The distribution pipes are generally laid below the road, prevented, and as such their layouts generally follow the layouts of road. There are in general 4 different types of pipe networks, any one of which either singly or in combination can be used to a particular place, like a grid, ring, radial, and dead end system. Now let us see the first one, grid iron system. It is suitable for cities with rectangular layout where the water mains and branches are laid in rectangles. Advantage: the water is kept in good circulation due to absence of dead ends. In cases of a breakdown in some section, water is available from some other direction. Disadvantage: the exact calculation of size of pipe is not possible due to provision of valve on all the branches. Second one is the ring system. The supply main is laid all along the peripheral roads and sub mains branches out of the mains. Thus, the system also follows the grid iron system with the flow pattern similar in the character to the dead end system. So, a determination of the size of the pipe is easy. Advantage of this one is the water can be supplied to any point from at least 2 directions. Next one is the radial system. The area is divided into different zones. The water is pumped into distribution reservoir kept in the middle of the each zone, and the supply pipes are laid radially ending towards the periphery. Advantage is it gives quick service. Then the calculation of pipe size is easy. And the last one is the dead end system. It is suitable for the old towns and cities having no definite pattern of roads. Advantage of this one is the relatively cheap. Determination of discharge and pressure easier due to the less number of valves. And disadvantage of dead end system is due to many dead ends, the stagnation of water occurs in pipe. Means there is the pipe in water is collecting in a pipe, so it is not easy.